Hey everybody, Tim Albrecht here, and thank you for listening to the YFP podcast, where each week we strive to inspire and encourage you on your path towards achieving financial freedom. This week I had a chance to sit down with entrepreneur and pharmacist Chris Cozzolino to talk about his journey with several businesses that he's been involved with as a recent 2020 graduate of the University of Iowa. Some of my favorite moments and takeaways from this interview include hearing from Chris about his decision as a new practitioner to not pursue a traditional career path, but rather start his own business. Also talking about why he is prioritizing LinkedIn as the platform to generate authentic conversations that promote personal and professional success. And we dig into the work that he is doing as the co-founder of Uptown Creation, a B2B business development and consulting firm. Really cool story, one of my favorite episodes of this year, of a pharmacy entrepreneur who is using his PharmD in a non-traditional way. Before we jump into the episode, I want to invite you to a free webinar that's happening on November 10th at 8:30 p.m. Eastern. Dr. Jeff Keimer, our good friend and author of FireRx, The Pharmacist's Guide to Financial Independence, will be joining me to talk about the FIRE movement, aka Financial Independence Retire Early, how pharmacists can overcome common barriers to achieving financial independence, how to calculate your retirement need, and some investment considerations for those that are on the FIRE path. Plus, if you attend the webinar live, you'll be entered for a chance to win a copy of Jeff Keimer's book, FireRx. You can register by going to yourfinancialpharmacist.com/webinar. Again, that's yourfinancialpharmacist.com/webinar. All right, let's hear from today's sponsor, Thoughtful Wills, and then we'll jump into my interview with Chris. This week's episode of the Your Financial Pharmacist podcast is sponsored by Thoughtful Wills. Let's take a minute to hear from co-founder Notesong.
Hi there, I'm Notesong, one of the founders of Thoughtful Wills. Our law firm specializes in creating custom estate planning documents that are understandable. We've leveraged technology to offer a lower price point than most law firms, and honestly, it's refreshingly affordable. As our client, you're in the driver's seat. We're here if and when you have any questions or just want our input. Our explanatory worksheet and online interview gathers your answers whenever and wherever is most convenient for you. As a busy mom of three sweet kids and two fluffy sheepdogs, I totally get it. Life is crazy busy. Who has the time? We designed our firm around that too, and we poured our hearts into making our estate planning process less of a hassle. I invite you to visit thoughtfulwills.com/YFP to learn more. Give us a jingle or drop us a note. We'd love to chat with you.
Chris, welcome to the show.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Tim.
Really excited to have you on and feature your entrepreneurial story and how that's connected in with your pharmacy journey. And one of the things I've mentioned on the show over the last several months is a goal I have to feature more pharmacy entrepreneurial stories with the hopes that more folks will see the PharmD as a potential pathway that can go many different directions. And my thought is not that folks hear Chris's story and say, hey, I'm going to go do exactly that, but rather it inspires and motivates folks to think differently about how they might leverage and utilize the PharmD. Chris and I actually share a mutual friend, Ashley Clevens-Hayes, that connected the two of us. And we had Ashley on this show, episode 95, when we talked about how to level up your career. And just a couple weeks ago, Chris and I did a LinkedIn Live, and I left that conversation really feeling energized and motivated to take some of the expertise and information I learned from Chris to accelerate our own business at YFP and to be able to serve and fulfill the mission that we have to help pharmacists achieve financial freedom. So excited to introduce Chris to the YFP community if you don't already know him. Chris, before we get into your entrepreneurial journey, share a bit about your background, where you went to pharmacy school, when you graduated, and what drew you into the profession.
So originally, I am from the southwest suburbs of Chicago. And so when I was looking at universities and everything, University of Iowa was close enough to be close to family, but far enough away to still get away like you're trying to do early in college. And I was lucky that they have a great healthcare program going into it. Kind of, I knew that I wanted to do something in healthcare. I grew up in a family. My dad was in the state police. My mom was a dietitian, and my brother has cystic fibrosis and is doing really well with it. But I kind of saw medications my whole life. So that was a big part of being interested in medicine. And then going in early to college, really falling in love with chemistry. I just really enjoyed those classes and also the just the like philosophical concept of being able to take a substance in medication that can then solve a problem. And that really providing control to otherwise uncontrollable situations. And that's kind of how I've always thought about medicine, is it puts control back into people's hands, which was a nice thought. And I liked that component of everything. Then the other big aspect, so I went to pharmacy school at University of Iowa. And the big thing that drew me to pharmacy outside of all those other things was the ability to work remotely and to be able to work in different places. So, you know, a lot of times if you're a physician or a dentist, even you kind of set up practice and there's a lot of opportunity to be entrepreneurial. But once you set up that practice, you're building your book of business and you're kind of set there. Obviously you can build it bigger. You can move yourself out of the role, but I liked the idea of being a pharmacist. There's CVS, Walgreens, pharmacies all across the country. So if I wanted to travel or live in different locales, it was very doable. And then also after kind of that realization that I wanted the freedom to be able to move around, I also realized that there was a remote component with medication therapy management and those roles that were popping up. So the concept of working remotely before it was so common practice was another thing that kind of drew me in to the space.
Chris, you mentioned some things that I would think of as more traditional that drew you into the profession in terms of some of the science, chemistry, you know, obviously the ability, the impact on patient care, but you're taking a very non-traditional, you know, career path. And I don't know if I love that term because I'm hoping we'll get to a point where, you know, we recognize, to my comment earlier, that the PharmD is really just the beginning of one's career path and their opportunities. But when folks hear me say non-traditional, they know what I mean. And so you're relatively young in your career, you haven't taken that, you know, traditional clinical pharmacy job where you're utilizing your PharmD as much on a direct patient care. And we're going to talk about the work that you've done in various entrepreneurial efforts, whether it be the drop shipping business, other summer accelerator programs, the work that you're doing with Uptown Creation. But nonetheless, it's been in a different direction. And so my question here for you is, like, what's the why behind that? As you reflect back on this first part of your career, like, why not a traditional career path? Why do you think you've gone in this other direction?
Yeah, that's a good question. And I think the biggest thing for me is I've always enjoyed creating things and being able to play around. And there's a lot of opportunity to do that within healthcare and within pharmacy. So even though the projects that I'm working on right now, I have an inkling that it'll come back to healthcare and come back to pharmacy in one way or another, where I'm able to kind of tie entrepreneurship, growing companies, and doing that within a healthcare model. But the other thing that has always been kind of an ethos of what I'm trying to create is being able to build something that's bigger than myself. And if I'm trying to have as large of an impact on the world as I want to have, knowing that I'm going to have to take a lot of things out of my hands and be able to build a machine or a process or a system that is able to put other people into seats that can extend that reach. And that's kind of one of the concepts of why social media, the internet, and being able to reach a lot of people at once has always been a fascinating concept to me, because the impact that you're able to have as an everyday human is pretty robust with everything that we kind of have at our fingertips.
Yeah, really unique opportunity, right, in the time that we live in. Your desire for contribution, Chris, really stands out to me. I just finished reading The War of Art by Stephen Pressfield, which is just an awesome, awesome book. And he's got a follow-up called Turning Pro. And one of my favorite passages from that book is he says, "Creative work is not a selfish act or a bid for attention on the part of the actor. It's a gift to the world and every being in it. Don't cheat us of your contribution. Give us what you've got." And I sense that desire in the conversations you and I have had, and we're going to talk about how that's threaded throughout your journey. But I often wonder, you know, and obviously I'm looking at it through the lens of the financial plan, sometimes being a barrier to folks being able to achieve some of the potential that they have and the ideas that they want to contribute. And so we're passionate about that part of it. But I often wonder, as a profession, like, what could we fully contribute if everyone's giving everything they've got and they have that mindset and we remove some of the barriers? And I think sharing your story and others is hopefully a source of motivation and inspiration for folks to consider that question. Chris, your entrepreneurial journey, we're going to talk in a little bit about the business that is today in terms of what you're doing with Uptown Creation. But, you know, I think with most entrepreneurs, they can point back to a younger version of themselves where maybe it wasn't a formalized LLC or business structure and you didn't have a team and employees, but you were hustling in some entrepreneurial way. So take us back to when you can remember that entrepreneurial journey beginning for you.
Yeah. And I think the start was really when I was like 12 or 13 and playing World of Warcraft, a video game, and seeing digital currencies that people wanted and digital assets that people wanted, which is a whole nother conversation that started up again with NFTs and everything. But being able to sell like gold in World of Warcraft was the first way that I made money before even having a job. And then I started to referee as a soccer referee and then had a variety of jobs from there. But really that first playground that I had was being in a video game and kind of trying to learn supply and demand, but actually make money as a 13-year-old by selling 1,000 gold coins through PayPal to random people on the internet was that original bug, I guess, where I was able to scratch that itch of fulfilling something. Then outside of that, I didn't really do a whole lot other than having, you know, minimum wage jobs throughout my high school career and then early college. And then I always thought there was something that I was missing with like seeing stores buy something cheaper and then sell it for more expensive and make money on that. And it just seemed like such a simple concept that there had to be something that I was missing to, or otherwise everybody would be doing that. So it kind of coincided with Amazon seller marketplace rising a lot and e-commerce rising a lot more. So this was back when I was a junior in college, probably 2015. A junior at Iowa. So I did my undergrad in biochemistry at Iowa. So when I was a junior, I was working as a pharmacy technician. I was working in a cystic fibrosis research lab, and I was just looking for other ways to supplement income. And the term dropshipping came up, and that's something that I just became fascinated with because it was a way that you could sell physical products and not hold an inventory. That's usually the biggest barrier I found with buying something cheaper, selling it for higher, is you have to put that upfront cost in to get that thing for cheaper and then sit on that inventory to then be able to sell it. But dropshipping took away like that variability. So the initial business that really got me involved in the entrepreneurship community at University of Iowa, which I'm lucky that they have such a good program and had so many connections and ways to foster an environment. I know not every school has that, but that was the original business model. And so to break it down even more simplistically, I was following somebody on Instagram who was talking about finding products on eBay and then selling those products on Amazon.com and never having to purchase the product until it was already sold. So somebody would buy it from you on Amazon. You would get their shipping information, their name, and then you could take that information and go back to eBay and put that into the shipment address and then put your credit card information in, and it would just ship the product directly to that Amazon customer and you collect the profit in between. So that was the first low barrier to entry that I had to be able to experiment again. And the risk was pretty low and I was able to do it with, you know, a credit line of like $1,000 because I was a college student with nothing but debt and nobody wants to give you money or a credit card. So I was able to do that with limited startup costs. And that was a big factor of that being kind of the first step into. But I learned a lot about customer service, about human nature, and about expectations that people have when they're purchasing something.
Yeah. And I love that as an example. And as you mentioned, you know, some of the big barriers to starting a business can be upfront capital, can be inventory holding times, right? Especially when you're talking about product-oriented businesses. So being able to learn some of those lessons, which I would argue you probably already see a direct connection to the benefit that's been and furthermore will into the future. But to be able to learn those lessons without having to go through that pain of, you know, going further into debt and so forth, extremely important. So you did you continue that through pharmacy school then?
Yeah, so I continued that through pharmacy school and I continue that to this day. And it's evolved a little bit more from an Amazon to eBay dropshipping model So we have other suppliers, but the big versions of selling are selling products on Amazon and sourcing those from walmart.com, and then vice versa, selling things on walmart.com as a Walmart seller and sourcing those from amazon.com. So really the terminology for it, if people want to look it up, is it's a combination between drop shipping and retail arbitrage is really what it is. And retail arbitrage usually is done by people, you know, going into Walmart, finding a sale, checking it on other websites online. And if they're able to make money, then they'll go check out at Walmart and then ship that product out. This is kind of the way to do it at scale without having to physically go into a store, but just doing it online.
Chris, my naive, I'm following the methodology, and I suspect we have many that are listening, maybe interested in a side hustle that are going to go down this rabbit hole, which is cool. My naive understanding of this type of opportunity brings up a question. I often think of businesses that might be built on the back of something else versus businesses that you have full control over. So we're going to talk in a moment about what you do at Uptown Creation. And in that environment, Chris and co-founder and partners can make decisions tomorrow, right? Today, and do what you want in terms of the business and the direction. When I think about a business model or a side hustle, whatever you want to call it, with something that we've been discussing that might be built on the back of like an eBay or a Walmart or an Amazon, what challenges does that present as well as perhaps opportunities? And how do you, as an individual that is trying to grow something strategically, whether you look at that as a business or not, how do you plan for some of those unknowns that are out of your control when it's not on your own platform?
Yeah, and I think that is a great thing to bring up. And that is one of the, I wouldn't say risks, but one of the pitfalls is that, you know, Amazon can stop people from selling at any point on their platform. And then you're reliant on that as your sole business. You know, you're kind of at the mercy of whatever platform you're using. So by the benefit that you get is you get all the attention that Amazon has and all the web traffic that Amazon has. So that's the benefit of, you know, using another platform that isn't your own, but then you're at the mercy of that platform at the end of the day. That kind of goes into the whole social media part of things. So anybody who has tried to, you know, build a brand or build something on social media probably understands that they're at the mercy of that platform, whether it's Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn. So to be able to mitigate your risk, I think first being able to identify like that is a risk that needs to be overcame. And I know with, let's say, Instagram influencers, for example, if Instagram was to go away, so many of those influencers would, you know, be wiped off the face of the planet and nobody would know who they were. So being able to make the brand bigger than the platform is kind of the best of both worlds, in my opinion, whether it's, you know, selling physical products, building your personal brand, or anything else where you're leveraging something on the internet. It's a matter of being able to use that platform, that traffic, because it's convenient and it drives a lot of traffic and attention, but then being able to do something with that you're able to take people someplace else. So for example, you know, if I wanted to make my Amazon business bigger than just my place on Amazon, I would include packing slips, for example, that would direct people to, you know, my personal website where they could check out the other products. Maybe there's a little bit of a discount if they go there. But then now I'm taking the traffic from Amazon and directing it someplace that I have a little bit more control over.
And you see so many companies doing this, right, that are trying to get to that direct-to-consumer relationship. And I think for the reasons that you mentioned, that was a lesson, Chris, I learned early on in YFP. I think I might have picked up on that from some of Pat Flynn's work with Smart Passive Income. But, you know, the concept of being at the mercy of an algorithm, right? And that could change and has changed, you know, in different platforms. And how do you diversify across platforms? And then how do you utilize them not as the end game, but as a source to further promote and build that relationship with the community, the audience that you have, and then convert that traffic? You know, so like for us, you know, a big part of that is getting folks over to our platform and thinking about a way we can then engage with them, you know, via email or other types of educational offerings that we want to do. But, you know, if I've fully built the YFP community on the back of Facebook or Instagram or whatever, and something changed drastically tomorrow and I wanted to promote a webinar, all of a sudden I don't have an audience to promote to, right? So I think there's a lot of wisdom in what you said. So you started the drop shipping business while you were in college, found some success in it, I've continued to grow it, but that didn't stop you from starting another business. So talk to us about Uptown Creation, what it is, and what's the story behind why you launched the business and ultimately the problem that you're trying to solve?
Yeah, that's a great question. So Uptown Creation was founded in early 2016. And with my current business partner, who also went to the University of Iowa, his name's Connor Paulson. And we both had companies beforehand. So he made a men's leather good company where it was very personalized leather good products that he was creating, like bags, duffel bags, everything like that, belts. But you were able to have a, his customer was able to have a part in the creation of it, you know, from, you know, meeting the leather worker that's going to be creating stuff, having things very, very customized. So he was in a business where the customer relationship and their customer experience was really at the center of it. And that's why they were able to do what they did, was they provided a great customer experience. Where what my business was more trying to scale things and do things at as large of a level as possible, and then kind of use the attention that was from another platform and drive it to myself. So we became friends through the entrepreneurship communities at the University of Iowa. So the Founders Club was a club where you kind of had to have a business, and then there were different tiers of it based on the income you were generating from your business. And that allowed you to do, you know, pitch competitions, startup accelerators, and everything. So Uptown Creation started in a startup accelerator at the University of Iowa. And Connor, my business partner, came to me and asked if I wanted to, you know, do this thing for the summer. We had some other people that were in it just for the summer. And it started off as a YouTube company, essentially, which is nothing what it is today. But the goal of it originally was to be an educational company and create YouTube videos to kind of teach people the things that college didn't teach you. So they went through that startup accelerator over the summer. I had already done one in the past, so I couldn't be directly involved and compensated that way. But I kind of had a back burner role in it. And that was as I was entering pharmacy school in 2016. So at the end of that summer, Connor and I looked at each other and the other people that were involved. It turned out that we were the only ones that wanted to continue doing anything with the business. So now it was Connor and myself, and we had to figure out kind of what to do. And that was the first big pivot, is we knew that we wanted to create some sort of education that we were able to provide to other people. The format we weren't married to, but we knew that YouTube was a way to make money from ads. But we knew that we also both had a background in selling physical products. This was at the same time that Instagram was initially talking about something called shopping on Instagram. This was back in 2016. They started to talk about it. It didn't get launched until like earlier this year, which is funny. But that drove us to learn Instagram. So one of the problems going back to Amazon that Amazon selling brings up is that Amazon takes a 15% cut of everything that you're selling. So we were naturally looking for other ways to sell physical goods then and have a little bit less of a cut be taken. And we saw Instagram as the potential for that if we were early on enough. So we spent the next couple months growing some Instagram accounts. And long story short, we realized that we were really good at growing communities on Instagram and growing Instagram accounts, that people started to come to us and want to pay us for that. So when you are making no money as a business and you have people that want to pay you for something that you're doing, you usually take that opportunity so you can keep the business going. So that was kind of the next big pivot in, you know, maybe we're not going to sell our own educational resources or our own physical products on Instagram. Maybe we're just going to help people do Instagram better than what they're doing it currently, and then let them get more attention for whatever they're working on, whatever products they're working on. So that kind of put me down the rabbit hole of learning the Instagram algorithm really, really well, learning social media marketing tactics specific to Instagram better than most people I can think of, and doing that through like online forums and kind of like the underground communities that exist in the growth hacking space. So I was in pharmacy school and also simultaneously doing that. I like to learn things. So that was a good hobby to have outside. But then we started to bring in clients, and people started to want to pay us for these Instagram services. I'm fortunate that, so this is, I guess, a good touch point to have. Another reason why my business partner and I decided to go into business together was we complemented each other very well. He is very front-end sales, talking to people, networking, probably the best networker I've ever met in my life. And I was very, I don't want to sell anything in a salesy way. I just want to make something that's really, really good. And then people can decide if they want it or don't want it. So I've always been more the service fulfillment and service creation component of the business, whereas I had a partner early on that did the things that I didn't want to do. And I think that's imperative because that set us up for success.
And I think you've done that really well, Chris. Like when I look at, if folks haven't looked, we'll link in the show notes to some of the educational content that you've done on LinkedIn, which we'll talk about here in a moment on YouTube. I think you have very much that persona of a desire to provide good value and good education. And from there, I suspect the business development opportunities come to be. So that complementary approach between you and your partner, I can see why that was so important and the value that you bring to the team. So pivot is a word you mentioned a couple of times. So you mentioned the beginnings with YouTube, the pivot to Instagram. And now I understand much of the work that you're doing focuses on LinkedIn. So talk to us about that pivot to LinkedIn and some of the services that you offer now and the types of clients that you serve.
Definitely. And so a commonality that about all the businesses that I've started have been kind of built on the backbone of something that already has a lot of attention, whether it's Amazon selling, whether it's Instagram, whether it's LinkedIn business development. It's always been being able to drive attention from something else. So like as I mentioned, you're also at the mercy of that platform. So we were using a lot of bots and automation on Instagram. Found out Instagram doesn't really like that too much. So they do their best to keep that stuff off of the platform. We realized that if we wanted to scale the business, we needed to not have those variables because, you know, it was easy to have 50 clients, 100 clients, but if we wanted to ever grow bigger than that, we wouldn't be able to wake up one day and Instagram changes their algorithm and now we have to rethink our whole process and deal with customer service of 100 people. So that let us down. Okay, what if we just played within what the social media platforms want us to do anyways? And that's, you know, creating real conversations, having a very human component to things. So that became the ethos of what we are today, is getting rid of bots and automation, putting a human in kind of all the seats that a bot would be taking, and being able to have genuine interactions with people using the internet as a means to contact the right audience. So as Uptown Creation sits today, it's a business development company really focused on direct outreach campaigns. So what that looks like in practice is, you know, targeting people on LinkedIn and then starting conversations in their inbox, but not the spammy messages that everybody receives, more of a message. You know, I think giving an example, if I was going to reach out to you, Tim, I would go to the YFP website. I would look at a podcast. I would try to find an episode where I'm able to bring up a guest's name, listen to the first 10 minutes. And now when I message you, I'm going to bring those things up. And that's how I'm going to inevitably start that conversation and hopefully get you to respond, because while you have 20 other messages that are clearly spammed out to everybody, this is the message that you know is sent to you directly.
And that's how genuine conversations and rich relationships and meaningful long-term relationships start, right? Is having a true vested interest in someone else and identifying where that collaboration can happen. So I love that approach. And as I mentioned, we'll link in the show notes, you did a great series on YouTube, kind of going step by step through the LinkedIn process and what you guys have done with clients in terms of looking at that as a business development opportunity. When I look at, Chris, your LinkedIn presence, and again, we're talking here from the mindset of, you know, it's not just about the number of followers and how many people can message, but authentic relationships. And the fact that you've been able to build those authentic relationships, also build a large profile, a large following of what you do, I think over 20-something thousand, you know, folks that are following the work that you've done. Talk to us about the positive impact that has had on you professionally, personally, as well as for the business and what you're doing at Uptown Creation.
Yeah. So personal branding has been kind of a buzzword that I'm sure everybody's heard that was a big component of the work I was doing on Instagram, a big component of, you know, what people talk to you about as you're going through pharmacy school. And the way that I like to talk about personal branding is really it being your reputation and nothing more, nothing less than that. But personal branding kind of being the online word for it. But in the real world, you have a reputation. People think of you or hear your name and they think certain thoughts or remember certain things that they've seen. And really, since I've done so much consulting work with clients of trying to get them to create content, trying to get them to spread their message, use the free traffic that the internet provides, I realized I needed to also do that myself and be a practitioner of that, which was uncomfortable for me at first because that's not my natural way of being. I think a lot of people think that, oh, if somebody's creating content or creating videos, like they're seeking attention, they're more outgoing than I am, they're, you know, all these other preconceived notions that people may have, when in reality, it's really just being an effective communicator and also building your reputation online. So, you know, with the community that I've built up through my own LinkedIn outreach and content creation, there's been a lot of great relationships that I've made. I mean, this is one of them because I don't think I would have ever met you, Tim, if I didn't have those other interactions with other pharmacists that say, you know, you really need to talk to this guy. So just from a sheer meeting people in the industry component, I don't think that that can be understated how much that has helped. I mean, even with jobs that I've been offered in pharmacy specifically, and just the conversations I've been able to have with people greatly exceeded my expectations. And the cool thing about it, especially in healthcare and pharmacy, is that, you know, in the entrepreneurship communities and business, this is nothing new. Everybody's been creating content for a decade or more since YouTube came out as a platform. It's still really new for healthcare. There's not a lot of people that are, you know, known for things online or have a brand. I think Zdog MD is probably one of the biggest brands that exists that a lot of healthcare people know. It can set you up for speaking engagements, for having those side hustles, those side gigs, but also creating something that you're known for that then you can progress your career with.
I would add to Chris, you know, I think the benefits professionally to many folks, you know, I think may seem fairly obvious in terms of opportunities and the network and the relationships that come from that, or, you know, in your case, what that means for the business. I also just get a ton of fulfillment and joy in really connecting with other pharmacists, learning about what people are working on, what problems they're trying to solve, opportunities they have, frustration, challenges they have. That's one of the things I love most about the work I do at YFP is I get to have conversations like this or talk with prospective clients and pharmacists all across the country at all different phases of their career. And so don't underestimate, the point I'm making here is don't underestimate, you know, folks listening of, yeah, I mean, it's going to have professional benefits for sure, but also just some of that personal satisfaction and joy that can have from developing those meaningful relationships. Chris, so I know you're at the time of recording, you're doing some strategic planning for the business right now. And so I'm curious, as you think about the evolution of the business thus far, you've talked about a couple pivots that you've made. You put your hand on the crystal ball, like what does Uptown Creation look like in 3 or 5 years? Where do you guys see yourself going?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I want to make it like explicitly clear that Uptown Creation started as making YouTube videos on the internet, went to Instagram and is now at a completely different spot with, you know, direct outreach marketing. So I think that's a good learning lesson for a lot of people in that, especially pharmacists that are looking to do anything outside of pharmacy or even just start a side hustle, it's good to get out of your own way sometimes and just start and know that it's going to evolve into something else. And that's okay. As long as whatever that end mission or that end goal is being accomplished, I think a big thing that people do wrong in entrepreneurship is they fall too in love with the product or the service or that identity of what they're doing rather than the end impact that they're trying to have. And if you know that the journey to getting to that end can change and it's okay, I think that makes it a lot more freeing that it doesn't have to be what you're doing right now, but you have to start to be able to get to that end point. So going back to your question of kind of what the outlook for Uptown Creation is, we are very clear now kind of on what we're good at and what we do. And that is direct outreach marketing, meaning, you know, you can use paid ads, Facebook ads, and other paid forms of traffic online to bring people in. And that's what's called like a one-to-many approach. you're showing an ad to thousands of people. What we are the experts at and growing our services in is the one-to-one approach and being able to have very specific targeted conversations. So as the mediums change that are effective right now, LinkedIn, email marketing, even cold calling and cold texting are still really effective ways if your targeting is right. But that's going to change over the next 5 to 10 years, which is okay. And, you know, LinkedIn might not be the best platform to do outreach on, and because that's not where people are hanging out online. And that's when we'll make more pivots, but really being on the bleeding edge of direct outreach marketing, conversational marketing, social selling is the term that's another buzzword, is where we're headed over the next 5 years.
I love that. And it's so in line with what you just shared, which is great advice of for folks that are growing something or thinking about something is, you know, keeping that goal and vision you have in mind, understanding the methodology of getting there might change, likely will change, just given how quick things are evolving today.
The one thing that I want to plug as well, because I think that this is like interesting insight for people. The reason why marketing and direct outreach is interesting to me, as I'm 27 right now, I plan to have other businesses. I want to do things in healthcare. But if I'm able to build this engine of direct outreach, bringing in traffic, starting conversations, this is something that I can apply to future businesses that I create regardless of the industry. So building this engine early on in my career that can then be applied to other companies in the future.
Great, great stuff. Chris, I want to talk about the concept of developing your craft. And I'm a follower of the Uptown newsletter. And this morning came out and you said the following: what I love most about Uptown Creation is that what we do just makes sense. It makes sense that reaching out to someone on the internet is an extremely personalized way would elicit a response. And this is what sets the framework for us as an organization. As the marketplace continues to evolve, we will evolve faster because we are practitioners of our craft and practitioners always win. What does it look like to be a practitioner of your craft? What do you mean by that?
Yeah, and that's a little Gary Vaynerchuk insight there. It was somebody that I follow and admire. But really being the person that's doing the thing that you're selling or the thing that you want to be known for can't be overstated. So that's why there's so many pharmacists out there, you know, that are experts in oncology, experts in nutrition, experts in all these different fields that are practitioners every single day and have things that are worth sharing to people that aren't doing that every single day, even if you don't really see that yourself. If you're doing something every single day, you are an expert, whether you like it or not, in that thing. And you know more than 99.9% of the population that's not in that thing. So really making sure that you always have your finger on the pulse, so to speak. And by doing whatever you're known for or whatever you're in business for, you can never be blindsided. I think a lot of business owners start to grow as a company and you have to put other people into a lot of the seats that you were doing before, but always being able to be close to the ground and be doing things yourself that are directly related can't be overstated, because that's the way that you stay up to date.
Great stuff, Chris. Really enjoyed the conversation. Appreciate you taking time to come on and share your story. Look forward to having you back on the show in the future as you further develop some other projects that are coming. What's the best way that folks can connect with you and reach out to you if they have a question and want to learn more about the work that you're doing?
Yeah, connecting with me on LinkedIn is probably the best. So Chris Cozzolino, Cozzolino. And then my email address, if anybody wants to email me, is chris@uptowncreation.com. And checking out uptowncreation.com is probably the next best way to learn more about what we're doing.
Awesome. We will link to those in the show notes so folks can reach out to Chris. And Chris, thanks again for your time.
Yeah, I'm excited for future conversations.
Today's episode of the Your Financial Pharmacist podcast was sponsored by our friends at Thoughtful Wills. If you haven't created your estate plan yet, we urge you to reach out to Notesong and Nathan. They draft custom estate planning documents like wills, trusts, healthcare directives, and durable powers of attorney that fit your situation and reflect your wishes. This is key. These are custom legal documents created and reviewed by actual attorneys. Thoughtful Wills created two cut-to-the-chase packages designed for pharmacists who are ready to get their estate planning in order. You'll really appreciate their dedication to approachable lawyering, and they charge about half of what most law firms charge for the same documents. These documents are such a gift to your loved ones. If you haven't created them yet, please just get it done. Reach out to Notesong and Nathan by going to thoughtfulwills.com/YFP. Go ahead and book a meeting with them. They'll take such good care of you. As we conclude this week's podcast, an important reminder that the content on this show is provided to you for informational purposes only and is not intended to provide and should not be relied on for investment or any other advice. Information in the podcast and corresponding material should not be construed as a solicitation or offer to buy or sell any investment or related financial products. We urge listeners to consult with a financial advisor with respect to any investment. Furthermore, the information contained in our archive, newsletters, blog posts, and podcasts is not updated and may not be accurate at the time you listen to it on the podcast. Opinions and analyses expressed herein are solely those of your financial pharmacist, unless otherwise noted, and constitute judgments as of the dates published. Such information may contain forward-looking statements, which are not intended to be guarantees of future events. Actual results could differ materially from those anticipated in the forward-looking statements. For more information, please visit yourfinancialpharmacist.com/disclaimer. Thank you again for your support of the Your Financial Pharmacist podcast. Have a great rest of your week.